Hello everybody.
Hello everyone.
We are here today with Benoît to talk about the Akinio queuing system. So first, back to the basics. What is a PIM for? As a consumer, you need to easily find the right products regardless of the shopping medium. It could be an e-commerce, a marketplace, or a print catalog. By offering a PIM, we help companies to organize their product page. Product page is description, assets, technical information, etc. And we ensure that the information is complete, accurate, and useful. This allows for a rich purchasing experience that enables you to quickly find the products you need. So Akinio PIM product enrichment is split in three main steps. The first one is collecting the data. So from ERP, from media server, or just from supplier's file. Then we enrich and control the quality of the product information. For example, we can translate in different languages. And then we spread the products that are complete to multiple channels. Could be e-commerce website, marketplace, point of sale, etc. Then here is a presentation of our ecosystem. They are classified in many many parts, so you can see marketplace, DAM system, data providers, e-commerce website, etc. Thank you a lot to Webcool for their involvement on our ecosystem. They are our main contributor. Thank you a lot. And on this slide, you have also the marketplace website of Akinio, so feel free to have a look. About our technical stack, we work with a LAMP stack, so Linux, Apache, and MySQL and PHP. Our PHP stack is also based on the framework Symfony version 3.4. And for the front end, we have Node.js and Yarn. And also we use Elasticsearch for indexing the products.
As Romain said, when you're using a PIM, usually the PIM is connected with a lot of other systems. So in the input, you may have ERP, media server, suppliers, and in the middle, you will do all your enrichment and translation and maintenance of products. Then you will send your data to your multiple channels. And when you do that, it means that there's a lot of features that are linked to long-running process. For example, to import data, to export data and to do mass edit or quick export or rules engine. So yes, a lot of features are based on long running processes. So when we launch them in the background, because it's not possible to launch them while Julia is waiting for her page. So for example, let's take the example of Julia, and Julia wants to do a mass edit on several products. So she connects to the interface, she launches the mass edit process. The mass edit process will be launched in the background, and Julia can do something else in the meantime. So yes, it's asynchronous, so it means that Julia doesn't have to wait for the process to finish. And while the process is running, the process will define its status. So for example, it will set the status to started at the beginning of the process, and the process will be in progress, and then it will be completed. And once it has been completed, a notification is sent to Julia to tell her that it's finished. This is great. It works well. Julia doesn't have to wait for the process to finish. And Julia can do something else while the process is running, because sometimes long running process can take several minutes or several hours to finish. But what happens if the process crashes? So let's take again our example. Julia launched our mass edit. So the process has started. It's in progress. And for reason, the process crashes. It can be because of memory limits, can be because of bad data, it can be because of a bug in the application or the custom code. So in this situation, when the process crashes, the process will stay at the in progress status, because when the process is crashed, there's no way for it to change the status to something else. So from the point of view of Julia, the process is still running, and she will wait forever for the process to finish, because as the process crashed, it will not finish. And when you are using PHP, there's some situation where the process can crash. For example, when the memory limit has been exceeded, or when some errors can be caught has been triggered, and some other situations. So our very first version of Akineo, we implemented a way to monitor our process by using the PID. The PID is a process identifier on the Linux side. So let's take the same example. The process has started, it's in progress, and at some point, for some reason, it crashes. When Julia goes to the jobs page will check if the process is still running in the background. It will check if the PID is still attached to a running process. And if that's not the case, if there's no process attached anymore to this PID, then the jobs page will change the status to fail. This way, Julia knows that the process has failed. The main problem is that it only works on the same server, because to check if the process is still alive, we're using the PID, so it means that the front interface, the HTTP server, and the background process need to run on the same server, which is kind of shame, because it means that you cannot really use horizontal scalability to scale your PIM. So we implemented a watchdog parent process that has been done in version 2. So the idea is that instead of directly running the process from the HTTP server, we have another process which is far more simpler, whose job is simply to get a command from the web interface and to execute the job that has been required by the web interface. So this process will monitor the background process. For example, in this case, if we have mass edit, we have a process that will do all the mass edition on product, and this small process will have a look and will check if the big process is crashing or not. So we have same status, started, progress, then we have the crash. And in this situation, the process monitoring the mass edition will notify Julia directly that the process has failed. But what happens if the watchdog dies? What happens if the process that is monitoring the main process crashes? And it can happen, because this process is done as well in PHP. So we added another layer using standard system tools like Supervisor or Systemd. And Systemd and Supervisor will make sure that the process responsible for monitoring the other process, aka the watchdog or the job executor, this process will stay alive, or if it crashes, it will be restarted by Supervisor or by Systemd directly. This way, we're reducing a lot cases where the process is crashed and nobody knows about. It's almost impossible for the process to crash and that the status is not set to fail. So now we have a reliable control process. We monitor our process and we know if it works or not. But let's have a look at another situation. So we launch the process in the background. But what if Julia launched the processes, mass edit, Marie will launch, for example, an import, Peter will launch an export, Jimmy will launch another mass edit at the same time, Michelle will launch another mass edit, and Josh will launch, for example, another export, and Julia again will launch another one, and so on and so on. What we see here is that we can have a lot of processes running at the same time on the server. It means that the resources of the server can be used a lot. And in this case, we can even crash the server by having too many processes, too many background processes running inside the system. So we have no way to regulate resources usage of background processes because it's all linked to the way the users will use the application. So it may work for several months or several years, and at some point a lot of users are working at the same time, and the server may crash because of too many background processes. So that's where we'll introduce the queue. The idea of the queue is that instead of running all the processes at the same time, they will wait in the queue. For example, Julia's asked to run this process, Mary's same, and Peter's. So the process are stacked. The command for the process are stacked in the queue, Michelle's and Joyce's. And in front of the queue, we have consumer, daemon consumers, which are other processes that just take things from the queue and run them. This way, we are sure that the process we run on the server, the number of processes we run on the server, we can control it because it's the number of consumers of the queue that is alive, that are alive on the server. So we can now regulate how many processes are running parallel. This way, it's far more easier to make sure that we will not overwhelm the server or crash it. And this adds new interesting stuff because we can now distribute the load on several servers. For example, in this case, we have four servers. On each server, we have two daemon queue consuming the queue. So we'll be able to have at least 8 processes running at the same time on different servers. This way, if you have, for example, a lot of loads linked to a special event, or you know that in the night there's a lot of import and export, you can distribute this load on different servers. So now let's put things together. We saw how to manage the reliability question, how to monitor the process, and we saw how to control the resources used by our processes. So how it has been implemented in Akeneo, so we have Julia and the front interface. We have the jobs queue, and we have the process that is responsible to execute the jobs that are in the queue, and we can have multiple processes as we saw before. These processes, which are called daemon consumers, are started and monitored by supervisor or systemd. And when Julia push a job in the queue, then this process will monitor the mass-edit process, for example, of Julia, will start it, and it will monitor the mass-edit process of Julia. This way, we have the scalability, the ability to distribute the processes on different servers, and we have reliability because we have the watchdogs that is watched as well by another watchdog. And if the process crashes, the watchdog will make sure that Julia has been notified and the process status has been set to the right status.
Okay, so now let's see a bit more about the code. I will show you how to launch the daemon consumer, how to log, and how to debug. And then we will dive into the code. So first, this is a basic Symfony command. You just have to launch it on your server. The first example is how to launch one consumer on production environment. The second one is a feature we added for next release. It's about just consume a specific job instance. It allows you, for example, to dedicate a consumer to the UI or to the mass edit or to other system. For instance, we use it also for Franklin, one of our other application. And it allows us to ensure that there is a process that will take care of frontend feature. Another interesting point is how to redirect the output to a dedicated log file. This is basically what we should do for every job. Okay, now how to monitor and how to debug. When you launch the queue from the consumer, it's not you don't have the you cannot see what happened. So it's still possible to launch a job like before at the end, but yeah, to keep on to keep the ends and try to debug and monitor the backend process. So you can launch it with the following command, and yeah, if you have a Blackfire or if you want to debug with PHP MAMA for Xdebug, that's okay with that. Now let's dive a bit more in the code. I added the link to the GitHub code. So feel free to directly have a look here. And yeah, now here is the code of the job queue consumer. Some code has been removed because sometimes there is some stuff that can make it not very readable. So this is roughly what happened. Basically, it's an infinite loop. It consumes the next job execution in the queue. So this is the first line. While the process is running, we just update his health check status. Just we created a process, we launch it, and then we have an update of the health check. The health check is to know if the job is dead or not, and it allows us to keep track of dead processes. What else? We continue to update the health check each time we saw that the current process is running. In the real world, we have some code to avoid overloading the current process. So we have some wait time to avoid checking every second or every microsecond the status. And when the process is not running anymore, when it's finished, we update its exit status, and we know at this moment if it's a success or if there is some error, etc. About the job queue manager. The job queue manager is a class that has been done to manage the health status and link it to the consumer. It allows us to first resolve the job execution status. So we check the PID process status. If it's dead, then we set the status to fail. And we have different status to mark the job execution as fail. For instance, if it's down, we can mark it as fail. We can also update health check status. The update of the health check is we update at that time to tell that we have checked the health check at this moment. Then we have a job execution message repository. Basically, it consists in persisting an entity job execution message. I will present you that entity after. And it allows us to get the next available message. Basically, there is two main methods for the persistence. We create job execution message and we update them. And we have two methods to get the next available message. The first one is the basic one, and the second one is to filter. It's one of the features, the last feature we implemented. It's to get the last message from a list of codes. So it will filter, for example, for the mass edit and get only mass edit job execution message. And then we have two other classes. So one is an interface, but there is no other implementation. This is a job execution queue. So it allows us to publish a job execution message and consume a job execution message. You can publish it to publish it means you add a job execution message in the queue, and the other one is to consuming from the queue. And on the job execution message, so this is an entity that we store in the database. So it's linked to job execution ID. It's linked to the consumer too, and we have the create and the updated time to better follow them. What's next? So we did our first implementation 1 year and a half ago. We started to add some feature just this quarter, and we probably add other feature very soon. There is no promises on what I am talking here. We will do our best for that, but we will see. There is no engagement on that. So in the near future, we thought about a blacklist system. So today we have a whitelist to allow some job. We can do the same, but blacklisting them. We can also filter based on job types. So this is not something very easy today, but it could be easier for us to only have a consumer for mass edit, for example, or for import-export, etc. And I think we will also do some rework and cleanup on that part. And maybe in the future, we can also think about having the real messenger component, like reusing the one from Symfony. And for the infrastructure, plug it to RabbitMQ or something like that. That's mainly it. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your attention, guys. And we hope you enjoyed the talk.
Yeah, that's it.
Have a good day. Bye.